Penguin Random House Audio presents The Last Million, Europe's Displaced Persons from World War to Cold War, by David Nasaw. Read for you by Malcolm Hillgartner. This book is dedicated to those who, having lived through the most difficult moments any human can endure, affirmed their existence, their joys and suffering, their expectations and hopes, through the acts of writing, speaking, and recalling them for future generations. Introduction: The War's Living Wreckage. The violence of war did not end with the signing of ceasefires, truces, or peace treaties. War bled into post-war, and millions of innocents who had never taken up arms continued to suffer long after the soldiers had gone home. Germany was in freefall. Chaos reigned. National, regional, and local military, police, and political authorities had abandoned their posts. There was, literally, no one directing traffic, no one policing the streets, no one delivering the mail or picking up the garbage or bringing food to the shops, no one stopping the looting, the rape, the revenge-taking, as millions of homeless, ill-clothed, malnourished, disoriented foreigners, Jewish survivors, Polish forced laborers, former Nazi collaborators, all displaced persons, jammed the roadways, the town squares, and marketplaces, begging, threatening, desperate. Wandering hordes in Reich alarming. Allies fear grave problems may arise. Ask liberated to stay where freed. John McCormick of the New York Times reported in a front-page story on April 7, 1945, Germany has become history's greatest hobo jungle since the Dark Ages, New Yorker writer Joel Sayre cabled home on May 2nd. The American and British soldiers moving east into Germany, and the reporters who accompanied them, were transfixed by what Collier's magazine columnist W.B. Courtney referred to as war's living wreckage. Living, moving, pallid wreckage. It washed up and down the margins of the Autobahn in a dragging tide. It was composed of people of all sizes, ages, races, and varieties or garments. A few had bicycles, some pushed handcarts. The majority, however, rolled baby carriages. The baby carriage is the sorriest joke in Europe today, for you never see a baby in one. Instead, they are filled with pots and pans and tools and all the impediments of nomads. There were shivering maids and youths in shorts with legs blue and raw. There were released German soldiers with their army packs and cut branches for walking sticks. You knew the displaced persons by the bulk of their clothing and the magnitude of their bundles. A man wearing two or even three suits, a woman wearing several dresses and a couple of coats and carrying more, were not unusual sights. None seemed to want food. Their want lay sadly deeper, and you could not touch it with your pity, but could only surmise that it was for country and home and news of loved ones. Having once seen the wandering lost millions of Europe, you could never forget them, even as you could never fully know what thoughts were in their minds or what lumps were in their hearts. In the rain and wind, they were a steamy, abject porridge of human woe. Barely clothed in ripped and ragged, oversized, striped camp uniforms, the Jewish survivors were distinguishable by their pallor, emaciated physiques, shaved heads, lice-infested bodies, and the vacant look in their eyes. You could see them walking down the street, Chaplain Herbert Eskin of the U.S. Army recalled. Some of them, with torn shoes, barefooted, with their long coats, the women and the men with the pajamas, you know, dirty, very short hair, looking to talk to someone for aid. The vast majority of Jewish survivors remained in the camps, too ill to leave on their own. The soldiers who encountered them tell the same stories of initial shock, then disgust, accompanied by alternating waves of pity, anger, and stomach-churning illness, followed by a body and soul-wearying sadness that would not dissipate, a disillusionment with all things human, an enervating, pervasive disquiet that would remain with them for the rest of their lives. Their first task was the burial of the dead and the triage of the living. Thousands of corpses littered the ground, or were stacked in sheds or uncovered graves. Among the living were those known within the camps as the Musulmaner. According to the Shoah Resource Center at Yad Vashem, Musulman was the German term widely used among concentration camp inmates to refer to prisoners who were near death due to exhaustion, starvation, or hopelessness. The word Musulman literally means Muslim. Some scholars believe that the term originated from the similarity between the near-death prone state of a concentration camp Musulman and the image of a Muslim prostrating himself on the ground in prayer. These unworldly, ghostly, walking dead, too ill, too weak, too hurting to be moved, had to be bathed and fed in their barracks until they were strong enough to be removed on stretchers to hospital facilities. Those afflicted with or dying of typhus were quarantined and left to perish. Those who were ambulatory were moved to assembly centers to be patched together again and repatriated as soon as possible. On April 11th, Buchenwald was liberated by the inmates, hours before the arrival of the American army, but after the Germans had evacuated some 28,000 prisoners, a third of whom had died in sealed railroad cars or on arrival at their new camps or while trying to escape. On entering the camp, American soldiers from the 6th Armored Division of the 3rd Army found 20,000 inmates, 4,000 of whom were Jews. Chaplain Herschel Schachter of Brooklyn, the youngest of 10 children of Polish-Jewish emigres, commandeered a jeep and drove to Buchenwald the day it was liberated. As we approached the area, the first thing that struck was these huge gates. I walked through. I could see the huge smokestacks, and I rushed in that direction. There were piles of human bodies stacked like cordwood, waiting to be shoveled into the crematorium. I couldn't tarry very long there, and moved on looking for living Jews. I was peering into the faces of some people who were walking around, and I had no way of knowing who was a Jew and who wasn't. And I finally stopped one little guy who looked to me to be a Jew, and I just asked him in Yiddish whether there are any Jews here, and he said, of course, and he quickly led me to a small compound in this huge camp that was wholly reserved only for Jews. It was by far the most dilapidated and run-down area. There were in the first barrack a few hundred people who were obviously too weak, too sick, too bewildered to get out of the barracks. They were just lying there, looking out at me, half dazed, half crazed, more dead than alive. I didn't know what to say, what to do. All I did was call out in a loud Yiddish, Shalom aleichem Yidden, ihr seid frei. I was under the impression that many of the people there were not even aware of what had happened. I went from barracks to barracks, and in each one repeated the Shalom aleichem, and explained that I am an American, that I am a rabbi, and that we have come to help them, and that the war is over. And of course, I spoke in Yiddish, and they clearly understood and got the message, and I was everywhere surrounded by people who looked at me and touched me to see if it was real, if I was alive. Liberation for most of the Jewish survivors arrived with the American and British soldiers who entered the gates, calling out in foreign languages they did not understand that they were free. For others, it came when their German guards stripped off their uniforms, put on civilian clothes, and fled. The first thing I saw was the guards starting to get on their trucks or run away on foot. Henry Eisenman recalled a half century later of his escape from the Voblin concentration camp. With a group of other inmates, he ran toward the armory, grabbed the rifles left behind, and chased after the guards. Henry didn't know how to shoot a rifle, but the others did. And then we were free. For the thousands of survivors whom the Germans had moved from camp to camp in the last weeks of the war to prevent their being discovered and freed by the Allied armies, Liberation came on the roads, in the forests, on boxcars, in train stations, wherever they happened to be when the SS or the Hitler Youth or the overage members of the Volkssturm or the local volunteers who were guarding them disappeared. Allied soldiers set up checkpoints and roadblocks at major intersections and on the main thoroughfares, gathered the endless streams of the lost and homeless, boarded them onto trucks, and transported them to assembly centers where they could be sorted out. The German soldiers hiding among them dispatched to POW.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.